Very good afternoon to you all. So we start the next lecture on radioactivity and nuclear decay. Dr. Reddy, kindly begin your lecture.
Yeah. Good afternoon to everybody. I'm very sorry, last time there was a bit of mess which was beyond my control. Thanks to Tomar, you could step in. So now I will take from there, and the lecture, see, this part is already covered by Dr. Tomar. So I'll be talking about the decay processes, alpha decay process, beta decay process, and gamma decay, rather gamma transitions. And in this again, these are very, very lengthy parts. So I will try to give you the principles, so that you will have a feeling that you get some idea about these three decay processes. So before going into that, I just want to recollect what Tomar has told already, the meaning of decay processes and the changes associated with all the three decay processes. In the alpha decay, and you know by this time that a nucleus which is unstable undergoes, if it undergoes one of the decay phenomena like alpha or beta or gamma transition, then the remaining nucleus is called daughter product, not the emitted radiation. I'm sure you know that. So if alpha is the emitted radiation, the decay product will be having two charges less than it, and you might have told that. Anyhow, I will cover when you go to the decay processes, any doubt if you have. In the case of beta minus decay, that is fast electron decay or emission of fast electron, and anti-electron emission and electron capture process, the change in the atomic number is either plus one or minus one, whereas there is no change in the mass number. This is very important to understand the beta decay. Right? It has confused everybody, which I will explain. The conservation laws, it has troubled the while understanding the conservation laws, LAWS, and I will explain that. Since delta Z is plus minus one, and there is no mass change, these three processes are together called simply beta decay. And gamma decay is an excited state coming down to ground state. Okay, with this, I will go straight to beta decay. Probably we have to move about 30 slides or so. Today's lecture will start from here. The top is not seen. Are you seeing the complete? Okay. So I will start with the alpha decay process. Just now I was telling you that in alpha decay, an unstable nucleus emits an alpha particle in the process, and alpha particle, we know that it is equal to two neutrons and two protons, or it contains two neutrons and protons, and the nuclear part of it is called alpha particle, and it is nothing but helium nucleus. Now, when a nucleus loses or emits an alpha particle, obviously mass number will be changed by 4 units, and charge will be reduced by 2 units. And of course, all these decay processes, if you have got any time to look into the assignment I gave, which might have been uploaded, you will get the meaning of it, that when the starting nucleus, what we call parent nucleus, if it has more mass than the both daughter product and alpha together, then only decay processes is possible. If that is so, where is the difference of energy, that other mass? And mass and energy are intercommunicable. Therefore, that energy will be called, is called Q value of the decay process, and it is shared by both alpha particle, the lighter one, and the daughter product. For the case of alpha particle, it will be having kinetic energy, both are kinetic energies. Only thing is, this kinetic energy of alpha makes it to move forward direction, whereas the remaining part, that is daughter nucleus, gets a recoil. So the energy is shared by a light particle like alpha and a huge body called daughter nucleus. Therefore, their kinetic energies will be inversely proportional to their masses. So majority of the Q value is taken away by alpha, and the daughter product will get a small recoil energy. So by conservation of the loss, what conservation we have seen? We have seen mass is conserved. Before and after, the total mass will remain same. Similarly, charge has to be conserved. Two units, daughter product is having two units less, and alpha is having atomic number 2. Therefore, charge also is conserved. Now the next part is energy. So energy has to be conserved, that the mass of the starting nucleus minus mass of the recoil nucleus, that is the daughter product, minus mass of the alpha particle is the Q value. And that Q value, as I told, is shared by alpha particle as kinetic energy and the daughter product as the recoil energy. And if you take this in terms of, in this measurable value is the alpha energy of the kinetic energy of the alpha particle. Recoil energy measurement is not impossible, but generally not measured. Therefore, it is better to have a relation in terms of the alpha. And we know, I told that the heavy nucleus, that is the recoil nucleus, and alpha particle share the energy in inverse of their ratio. Total energy is constant. If you make a small arithmetic juggling, you get a relation Q is equal to E alpha into 1 by M alpha by M R. M stands for the mass. Here, to a good approximation, we can use the mass numbers. Actually, if one wants to get an accurate one, one has to use the mass value. But mass number is a good approximation. It gives the reasonably very correct values. So, by measuring the E alpha, we can get the Q value. Or if you know the accurate masses of both the parent and daughter nuclei, then also we can get the Q value. Now, I have told that all this energy will be shared by as the kinetic energy and recoil energy. But in the early days, when there were not many comforts of understanding, when the alpha energy was measured, they saw fine structure. They didn't see single value for the kinetic energy of the alpha particle. So people were wondering, what is this fine structure? Then of course, one could evolve the alpha theory understanding. And in the process, for example, in the case of bismuth decay, bismuth 212, undergoes alpha decay, and the product 4 mass units less, that is 208, and thallium 2 charge units less, this is 83 and this is 81, and they have measured 6 groups of alpha energies. And those days there were no alpha spectrometers. It was quite a bit tough, because from the ranges they have done it. So, and then they would attribute these different alpha group energies to the different energy levels of the daughter. So what is happening? Parent nucleus is undergoing the decay. When it populates the ground state of the daughter product, I wrote here GG, that is the maximum value. And that value, what we relate into this equation, whereas the remaining alpha particle kinetic energies correspond to populating the excited states of the 208 tally. Here, one important point is, if you measure the alpha decay energies, you will be in a position to find out the nuclear structure of this daughter product. And also, here I want to tell one point which you may try to remember. Then what is happening to, this is populated by alpha decay of 212 bismuth. What is happening to this energy? That energy will be in the form, general in the form of a gamma ray. Means it emits, de-excites from this excited level to ground state or intermediate states by emitting the gamma energy or successive gamma energies. So that the sum will be together to this two energy differences. So you get a series of gamma rays from here. Now you have to understand this, though these gamma rays are associated with the structure of 208 thallium, that is daughter product, they are always attributed to bismuth as bismuth gamma rays, because those gamma rays are seen only when alpha decay of 212 bismuth takes place. So this will be an useful information in the current day we obtain by measuring the either alpha decay energies, we can get gamma rays, or from the gamma ray energies itself, we can get back to the alpha energies. But we get an important point in structure of the 208 So this is one important thing, this nuclear properties, nuclear decays, all the way we go through to understand the nuclear properties, nuclear forces, and nuclear structure. Okay. So this is the thing what I wanted to tell, just to summarize this slide. Alpha decay takes place when the mass of the parent nucleus is more than the mass of the daughter product and alpha particle. And the difference is the Q value of the decay process, and that energy is shared as the kinetic energy of the alpha particle and recoil energy of the daughter product. And the lighter part which is emitted is not the daughter product. The remaining huge particle is called daughter product, and there it is not necessary that all the energy will be emitted in one go, going from ground state to ground state. It can as well go through intermediate states. It can populate the intermediate states of the daughter nucleus. Therefore, one sees a fine structure in the alpha spectrum, measured alpha spectrum, which helps in evaluating or arriving at the structure of the daughter product 208 tally. And the gamma rays, these states be excited essentially by emitting the gamma radiations. And these gamma rays are attributed as the, labeled as the gamma rays of the parent nucleus, not the daughter nucleus. Okay. Now, that's about the observation. The second very important observation, which has which demanded an explanation, is that when we move, before I go further, from the liquid draw model, we can see the limit of the alpha instability or the setting of setting point of the alpha decay that you can do yourself. And most of the, once the mass crosses 200, those nucleates in principle are unstable towards the alpha decay. I have taken the data of 5 nucleates here, 232 thorium, radium, radon, and another radon isotope, and polonium. Their decay energies I have given here. When, and also remember, this already Tomer might have talked to you, 4N series. That means the mass number of all these isotopes are divisible by 4, and they are called 4N series. They are all interconnected with the alpha decay. These isotopes belong to 4N series, and if we are moving from mass number 232, that is the starting nucleus, almost to the end nucleus, and the energy is varying from 4 MeV to 8.78 MeV. And that half-life we just see in terms of seconds, 232 thorium is 10 power 17 seconds. And whereas, I mean, that's about 10 power 10 years. And whereas by the time we come to polonium, it is 10 power minus 7 seconds. For a small change of 4 million electron volts, the half-life varies 10 power 24 times, 10 power 17 to 10 power minus 7. How it is happening? Why is it happening? This is an important thing in alpha decay to understand. Remember, a small energy change is changing its life, or in other words, it becomes more and more unstable. That is the meaning, easy to do. So this is the thing what I about here. Now, what was done is in the earlier days, natural alpha products only were available. Geiger and Nuttall, they have compiled all the alpha decay, measured alpha decay energies and compiled, they could arrive at a relation that log kinetic energy of the alpha particle versus log lambda. Lambda is decay constant, you know, by this time, half-life is T half and decay constant is lambda. They could arrive at a relation, linear relation for all the three series, natural series, 4n series, 4n plus 3, 4n plus 2 series, and that is log lambda is equal to A times log E alpha plus B, a constant. A and B are local constants for that series. Okay. So this linear relation is seen, what I have given in the tabular form, and the decrease is very drastic, that is from 4 MeV to 8 MeV. Of kinetic energy, half-life is varying about 10 power 24 times. Also remember, if you know the Coulombic barrier, the meaning of Coulombic barrier, I suppose all of you understand that if there are two charged particles, if you are bringing them together, one is having Z1 is the atomic number or Z1 electrons, other one is Z2 electrons, then the Coulombic repulsion, what I have shown here is given by Z1, Z2, E square by the internuclear distance R. As it approaches the nuclear dimension, it reaches a peak value, what we call Coulombic barrier value, highest repulsion. And this value, you see in some books as the EC, in some books as UR, VR, it doesn't matter. The meaning is that there is a Coulombic repulsion when two charged particles come together. We know the Coulomb law. It is also applicable here if you consider them as simple particles. Okay. Now, if you calculate the Coulombic barrier, for example, 232 thorium alpha decay, it comes about 22 MeV. Is it clear? 22 million electron volts is the Coulombic barrier for alpha decay of 232 thorium. But the kinetic energy observed is 4 MeV. Then how is it possible? What is the meaning of 4 MeV? The available excess energy for the decay process is shared by alpha particle and the residual nucleus. But how this decay is taking place? There is a Coulombic repulsion. So there are two questions. Alpha decay energy is very high. Alpha decay energy is low compared to the high Coulombic barrier energy, Coulombic barrier, which is about 22 MeV. Whereas alpha energy is in that family is 4 to 8 MeV. Under any circumstances, kinetic energy of alpha for all the isotopes is lower than the Coulombic barrier. Yet alpha decay is taking place. Unless, in principle, this kinetic energy is somewhere here, this alpha decay is very difficult to conceive. Right? Over and above, a small change in the energy from 4 to 4.5, 4.5 to 7, 7 to 8, there is a drastic change in the decay. That means decay probability is increasing exponentially. So, Gamow Gurney and Condon in 1928, they proposed a theory for the alpha decay to explain the observed Geiger-Nutter law or the observed alpha decay energies. For any nucleus, alpha decay energy is much, much lower than the Coulombic value. So in principle, this decay should not take place. But it is happening. How? Of course, these people proposed a barrier penetration. For that, preformation of the alpha particle inside the nucleus was conceived, which is very difficult to understand, because we know from the first two lectures we have seen that in the nucleus neutrons and protons exist, right? Alpha particle preformation is very difficult to conceive, but they have used a word: under favorable conditions a alpha nucleus will be formed, and if its energy is adequate, then it can penetrate. Now, instead of going through the quantum mechanical processes for penetration or quantum mechanical tunneling, I am presuming that you all have your 12th class in BSc physics proper, so I need not go into the quantum mechanical tunneling. I use the word as if you have the background. Now, how to, understand this? Now, instead of penetration, we simply think about a motorbike rider coming closer to a speed breaker, which is, I don't know how many of you have gone through Anshik Nagar, that is our residential colony. The speed breakers are axle breakers, really high speed breakers. If there is speed breaker which is, let us say, 2 feet high, then for sure we will think, an onlooker will think, that a car or motorbike cannot pass. Go to the other side. But nevertheless, that vehicle goes other side. How? They slow down and slowly climb and get down. So imagine this is at the speed breaker. This is the kinetic energy of the alpha particle. Then there is a possibility that it may come like this and go this way, right? But there, as far as the motorbike is concerned, this example was given by Fermi. And but you imagine motorbike, you have control. Here, where is the source for that additional energy or slowing down? This is the point where these three people proposed that this alpha particle will undergo a series of collisions against this barrier, as if there is a physical picture. But Coulombic ripple, if you have a Coulombic repulsive barrier, it is possible that alpha comes closer and gets back. In the whole process, this alpha, preformed alpha particle, gets adequate energy to reach the top and it goes off. So this is the way it is explained. So that means higher the gap, higher the gap, lower the probability. Obviously, 4 MeV alpha particle, if it is preformed, that will have lower lambda, that means longer half-life, compared to an 8 MeV alpha preformed particle, which will have higher probability, that is shorter half-life. So they could succeed on explaining the variation of the alpha half-life. In fact, they reproduced most of the half-lives for 4N series. But there were some limitations. There are many limitations, because considering this alpha preformation is very mild. But nevertheless, it explained. So later, after conceiving this idea, they used the quantum mechanics to arrive at the probability for penetrating, and from there they used a frequency factor which is related to the lambda, and most of the half-lives were reproduced in the case of even nuclei. Now, that's about the a brief understanding of the theory. But there were many observations that could not be explained. Obviously, because there are many assumptions which are very difficult to accept. For example, you see here, are you in a position to read? Sorry. Are you in a position to read here? I am not reading. This is blocking me. You are sharing my post. Okay. So, half-life and structure, what is the relation? You just see, I'll give an example here. 212 polonium decays by alpha and the daughter product is 208 lead. And this is having 82 photons. If you remember, Z is 82. Here it is 84. And alpha energy is very high, 8.95 MeV. And half-life is 0.299 microseconds. Very fast. Now, this is happening because the daughter product which is formed is having 82 protons and 126 neutrons, 208 minus 82. That is double magic number. So the daughter product is going to be double magic number, that is extra stable nucleus. So you have a system in which a nucleus is having extra energy, that is unstable towards alpha decay, but it is having a possibility of reaching a nucleus which is having double magic number. Therefore, that is a favorable decay. Therefore, its energies, you get more energy as well as very short half-life. There's large probability for this alpha decay because in one single go, it gets rid of this extra energy which is causing it instability, right? So remember, if the daughter product is having magic number configuration, alpha decay is favorable. Please remember, this. From this we have to understand that. If it is having double magic number configuration, that is more favorable. So all polonium isotopes that have 84 protons are alpha unstable because the final product will be lead whose atomic number is 82, irrespective of the mass number. Therefore, they all will undergo the alpha. This is one point we should understand from this. That is structure. Now you see the next nucleus. This is 213 aspartin and it goes to bismuth 85 and 83. Q alpha is 9.25 MeV, half-life is 0.125 microseconds. Here it is not double magic number, but 83 and 126. Therefore, neutron number is a magic number. Here it is 85 and 128. Here what we have to see is that the daughter product is having a magic configuration. Therefore, this is also favorable. Not only that, higher the proton number, more probable for alpha decay. But it is not a thumb rule, more or less that is true. So here, compared to polonium, astatine is having one more proton. Mass number is very comparable because you know that neutrons and protons together contribute to the attractive forces, whereas protons facilitate the repulsion. Even that one extra proton compared to this will lead to more instability, and therefore you are seeing the more energy and large probability resulting in short decay. Okay. I have another example here, 211 aspartin. Just see here, it's only two nucleons less, but neutrons are less, right? Proton number is same. And the end result, this is also having, what will be the end result? This is 83. And 124. There is no extra stability associated with the daughter product. So it is not a favorable configuration. compared to this, just 2 Newton number difference, that leads to a large, long half-life compared to this. From microseconds, you reach hours. And energy also, there is a reduction. Because of this structure effect, because both neutron number and proton number do not belong to magic configuration. Over and above, number of protons are same. Therefore, they are comparatively stable towards alpha decay in comparison to astatine 230. These are the finer points one has to understand. Okay. So now when we extrapolate this, if parent is having a magic number, obviously alpha decay is not favorable. Because from a magic or stable configuration, by emitting an alpha, it will go towards the less favorable configuration. Therefore, its energy will be lower, half-life will be longer. Okay. Suppose alpha decay is not at all favored here. Suppose if it happens, it happens. Then there is an extra energy. So where it will go? It will go towards, I mean, then electron capture will be a competing process. Okay. And in the case of a few nuclei, as high as 51% of electron capture PC. Okay. Now, if we plot for all the alpha decay isotopes, Q alpha value, not the alpha energy, Q alpha, total energy for the decay process, as a function of mass number, peak is observed, that is, highest Q value is observed when A corresponds to 128, because by alpha decay from 128, So when it is reaching 126, it will be a most favored one configuration. So here in this peak position, N corresponds to 128, not E. N corresponds to 128, not E. And since it is leading to 126, magic number, so energy is, alpha energy is high. So it is a supportive statement for all these. Okay. Now, you remember from these values, in a given element, Q alpha decreases with mass number. Why? Because Z is fixed, and as A increases, what will happen? More and more attractive forces will be there. Therefore, alpha decay is least probable. Therefore, Q alpha value decreases, half-life increases. For isobars, isobars means mass number is same, Z varies. Obviously, Q alpha increases with increase in Z, because the presence of more protons will enhance the alpha decay, the formation of alpha nucleus and alpha decay. It leads towards instability. Therefore, Q alpha value increases in a given family of isobars. These things we can even arrive at by using the liquid drum model, but time. Now, this is due to the variation of the Coulombic factor. Okay. From this plot, we can understand that the Q alpha value is higher if the N is equal to this N, please correct, N is equal to 128. And because by emitting an alpha particle, neutron number will be reduced by 2, leading to magic shell configuration. Q alpha in a family of isobars increases with atomic number because A is constant, more and more Coulombic force and lowering of attractive forces, And in the case of in a given element, mass increases, but two alpha decreases with increasing the mass. These are the values which are from the measured values. It is not predicted, measured values. So from this we can understand the role of the nucleus structure. Essentially, magic numbers and theory, and the role of the Coulombic factor. All these three things can be artifacts from this point. Okay. We will leave alpha decay here and move to beta decay. Beta decay is the one of the most confusing decay phenomena that were observed. In the beginning, of course, people got confused with the electron. Electron, is it a nuclear particle? That was the question. You know, that was spelled out very, that was removed from the minds of the many scientists then very fast. But the biggest question is, here you just see, in beta minus decay, a nucleus of atomic number Z gets converted to a nucleus of atomic number Z plus 1. It is equivalent to a neutron getting converted to proton and emitting a beta particle or beta ray, you call whatever, and plus an antineutron. Why antineutron? Somar might have explained, I will repeat. Here, the important point what we have to remember is mass number will not change. A will remain A only. Because A bound neutron, it is not free neutron, please. A bound neutron is getting converted to a bound proton. So proton remains inside the nucleus. Therefore, number of nucleons, which is sum of neutrons and protons, remains same. So mass number is not getting changed, right? So we have seen earlier, this is an isobaric decay. This family of isobars. It is observed in family of isobars because mass number is same. Now, when a bound neutron is getting converted to a bound proton, for charge conservation, an electron is moved. Does it mean that electron is nuclear particle? No. Answer is no. Now you see, one particle is producing two particles, right? How is it possible? Particle statistics are not conserved. Therefore, an antineutron is added here in the equation. How it was proposed, I will expand, right? So, a bound neutron gets converted to a bound proton, and an electron and an antineutron are emitted simultaneously. Very important is simultaneously. Now, if you calculate the de Broglie wavelength for an electron, you will find out that its de Broglie wavelength is much longer than the nuclear dimension. Therefore, we know that electron is a non-nuclear particle. It cannot be accommodated inside the nucleus. So is the case with neutron. Therefore, how to understand this? Pauli gave this explanation, and Fermi, both of them, Fermi in fact, gave the theory that when under favorable circumstances, under favorable conditions, since it's a bound one, suppose somebody wants to get out of the class. Now it is easy because nobody is observing. Suppose the teacher is standing, you have to see a favorable condition, teacher turning towards the board. Similarly here, the energy has to be, energy has to favor for this transition. A bound neutron should get adequate energy to get converted to a proton. In the process, you are forming an electron and a neutrino. Since they are non-nuclear particles, the moment they are formed, they are emitted. Because they don't have accommodation inside. They cannot be accommodated. So I will repeat a number of times this one, it should be clear. Neutron and protons are nuclear particles. Beta, which is fast-moving electron, and antineutrino in this case are non-nuclear, therefore they cannot be inside, and they are since they are non-nuclear particles, they won't exist in the first place. They will be formed at the moment when the energy is favorable, energy and other kinds, spin parity, etc. The moment they are formed, they are emitted. So simultaneously, you are getting two particles, and only measurable particle is weak lens. On the same extension, if the energy is more than, I mean, the mass difference is parent is more than the mass of the daughter product and twice the rest mass of the electron, then there is a possibility that a bound a bound proton, this I will correct and upload again send, a bound proton will get converted to a bound neutron. And for charge balance, it is zero charge, it is plus one charge. A positive or anti-electron is formed at that moment. For particle statistics, there is one particle, one antiparticle. You get a neutrino here. And both positron and neutrino are non-nuclear particles. The moment they are formed, they will be emitted. Now, you see here, I mean, you please read this as proton. Proton by itself is less mass compared to neutron. Its mass is lower than the neutron's mass. Therefore, a free proton in principle cannot decay to free neutron, because proton mass thermodynamics do not permit. And lots of experiments were done in India also, right? So, proton getting converted to neutron only is possible when it is part of a nucleus. Say a bound proton is getting converted to a bound neutron. For particle statistics, an antiparticle, that is anti-electron or positron, is produced. For particle statistics conservation, for particle conservation, a neutrino is simultaneously produced. Again, here the measurable part is only beta plus. Now the third one is electron capture. Again, when the mass of the atomic number, sorry, mass of the parent nucleus is more than the mass of the daughter nucleus, then it is unstable. That can undergo a decay. A competing mode is that an electron, orbiting electron, can interact with the nucleus, or there can be overlap between the wave function of the electron and nuclear, not neutron, nuclear wave function. There is a possibility that it will be captured, it will interact, and electron can be captured by one of the bound neutrons. In the process, it can get converted into bound proton. Two particles on the left side, so right side also there will be a neutron, right? So all the three processes together are called beta decay. And here the bound part you should not forget, and why we have antineutrino here, neutrino here. Now the very difficult part in this is, you see 32 proton, example I have taken 32 silicon. 32 proton is having a mass number of 15, is it not? Sorry, atomic number of 15, correct? 32 proton is, 32, 32 phosphorus is 15, but I'm good about it, but let me see, yeah, 15. Whereas sulfur is 16. Why I said these two atomic numbers is, change is only a neutron is getting changed to a proton, but the mass number remains same. If you remember the shell model, the nuclear spin of 32p will be half integer. So in the case with silicon, it will be half integer. But the emitted electron is carrying away half spin. Where from it is coming? The conserved, see, spin is not conserved. Is it clear, that question? Anyone can put on the mic and tell, speaker and tell. 32 phosphorus in this example, 32 silicon. I told a mistake here. 32 proton. Phosphorus is even, and 32 silicon is even. So they will have integer value of the nuclear spin, zero or integer value. And these values are not getting changed. They are not getting changed, but they are producing in this beta decay an electron. We all know that electron has spin value of half. So spin is not conserved in this process, right? Whereas atomic number, mass number, they are conserved. Spin is not conserved. And another thing is, see, when the energy was measured, just 1 second. Another thing is, when the energy was measured, in the case of alpha decay, energy has come, when you plot energy versus, I did not show you one, probably in detection part I will show one spectrum. They will give energy versus intensity simple peaks, right? That means the centroid corresponds to the alpha energy. Whereas in the case of the beta decay, in the next slide I will show, it is varying continuously until the Q beta value. Like Q alpha, Q beta value we can calculate from the exact masses. Mass of the parent minus mass of the daughter product minus mass of the electron. You get the Q value. And that Q value, people have observed betas with the energy varying from 0 to Q max. That is a Q beta value. Is the value is not single. Whereas in the case of alpha, it is either single energy or a bunch of alpha particles having single values. So then we know that from kinematics, in the case of alpha decay, one parent nucleus is becoming two parts. The lighter one is moving away, whose kinetic energy is measured. Whereas in the case of beta decay, we are trying to understand that there are possibility of two particles later part. But when electrons energy was measured, there were a continuous spectrum is shown, which I will show first and then come back to this. The energy was varying from 0 to 2 beta value, that is E max value. E right is 2 beta max, E max, or E0, one and the same, meaning is one and the same. Okay. So there is a continuous variation. And this value is corresponding to Q beta value. That is the energy associated with the beta transition. How is it possible? There are two violations. Energy is not conserved because each beta particle, whenever it is measured, there are different betas. Energies are different. But nevertheless, the end value is matching with the Q beta. Whereas the spin part, you have either even nuclei or even odd nuclei or odd even nuclei or odd nuclei, but they are family of isobars. Both the product and the parent and daughter have the same configuration, either even or odd or even odd, whatever it is, starting nucleus and final nucleus, there is no difference except in odd, even odd will become odd even. That is the meaning, right? So, and we also know mass number, depending on the mass number, we can predict the spin value, particularly for odd day it is very easy because one class of nucleons will be even, remaining one odd, that odd one last nucleon will provide the nuclear spin, right? So in the case of the any beta decaying pair, a parent nucleus and daughter product, an electron is emitted. Electron is carrying away a half spin value. So where is it? Where from it is coming? So energy is not conserved, spin was not conserved. Both these violations were observed until Pauli, he has proposed that based on the mathematics, that there should be a undetectable particle which may not have charge, therefore detection is difficult. and it is carrying away energy, and it has a spin. So by this bold proposal, all the things fell in place. The moment neutrino was proposed, then three-body kinematics was used to arrive at a reasonable estimate of the energetics. So what we have to understand is that spin and energy, non-conservation of spin and energy, has forced the introduction of neutrino hypothesis. And of course, in 1956, Owens and Rhines, they have detected neutrino, and neutrino detection is a challenging task. We also have facilities now being developed. So by the proposal of the neutrino, these two non-conservations could be explained. Now, I'd like to go back to one moment to the earlier slide, the one point I would like to convey here. So before we move further, electron, the energy of the electron varies between 0 to about, in general, 2 MeV. Exceptions are there, slightly higher energies also seen. And they correspond to relativistic region. And therefore, by using the magnetic measurements and using the relativistic relation, we can arrive at the V value. Once we get the velocity, then we can use the relation, and we know the magnetic field what we are using. We can arrive at the energy of the beta value. Beta energy we can arrive. Okay, that is the point what I want. Now we will move to the next one. Yeah, here this continuous spectrum I explained, but the beauty of this is, whichever part of the energy is, you can take a window of this spectrum, measure the half-life of that isotope, you are getting the same value. What does it mean? It means that whatever is the energy of beta, that particular beta particle is emitted by a parent nucleus which has unique half-life. That also has confusing people. So this continuous spectrum, besides the continuous spectrum or continuous spectrum, this observation that half-life remains constant helped in understanding that the nucleus, the genesis of the beta, which is coming out of beta decay, is from the same nucleus that whose half-life is defined as a constant for that component. So there are three points we have to understand from here. Beta energy is continuous, and any part of this spectrum represents the parent's decay, that is half-life. And spin and energy were not conserved, because this value, in principle, if neutrino was not associated, all the beta should have had this energy. But there is a variation. So this could be this force to introduce a non-detectable particle neutrino, which carries away a half spin, and it has a small mass, okay, and no charge. As I told you in 1956, that Owens and Cohen have determined, rather measured neutrino, observed experimentally. So Fermi proposed the theory, and this theory will take a lot of time, though I have few projections. I'll just give a brief briefing of this. Fermi's theory is, I mean, he has based this on the well-known theory at the time, electromagnetic theory. And electromagnetic field is replaced by a weak electron and neutrino field, and overlap between initial and final nuclear states, that is, parents and daughter products nuclear states were considered, and a statistical factor was considered, and they derived a relation, and statistical factor is directly related to the intensity here, and they could reproduce the spectrum shape. Then, since spectrum shape is reproduced, the hypothesis of Newton was accepted, and this theory also was accepted. From that, some selection rules were made, and beautiful, actually, I don't know if time is there, one should actually go through it, but it's impossible, you know. So probability for beta decay between two momentum intervals, you could calculate. From that, that nuclear, I mean, this beta energy spectrum was produced. And the influence of the nuclear Coulombic factor on the beta decay was also qualitatively explained, because if you measure a beta, and I will leave it here because this theory will take a lot of time. I have lots of slides I can share with you, but it will take a lot of time. And this helped in reproducing the beta energy spectrum. Now, the observed spectra for beta minus and beta plus, their shape is different. For example, beta minus, this is from 64 copper. 64 copper is a very nice example, which undergoes both beta minus, beta plus, electron capture, everything, right? It's a beautiful nucleus. And beta spectrum, it appears like this. That means initially high value, high intensity, later it goes on getting increased. Whereas beta plus, initially it is having high intensity of the low energy betas. As they move on, this will be less and less. How can we understand? Finally, this particle is coming from the nucleus. Nucleus is having positive charge. Think about beta plus. When it is formed, the moment it is formed, whether it is beta plus or beta minus being one nuclear particle, they will be pushed off. But nevertheless, there is some partiality. In the case of beta minus, nucleus will try to, as a whole, nucleus will try to hold the beta minus or delay its release, because it is having negative charge. Which one is having negative charge? Beta minus. Nucleus is positive. Therefore, the initial part of the beta spectrum will be having more intensity. That is the thing what we observe. Whereas in the case of beta plus, at zero energy up to some point, there is no, I mean, no observation at all. No beta plus is observed. They are simply pushed off, repelled, right? Therefore, they will be evenly distributed. So, using experimental data can be explained based on the nuclear Coulombic factor, and of course that was also reproduced by this theory. Now, another thing what we have to remember, if Z is 50 and above, more and more nuclear charge, and beta minus decay will be hindered or reduced because of the screening of the electrons. Because electrons are becoming more and more along with the atomic number. An electron, this is nuclear Coulombic factor. Whereas this is screening. In the beta decay, when an electron is formed subsequent to a bound neutron getting to change the bound proton, when it is coming out, right, a nucleus will hold it back, because positive charge and negative charge. In addition, there is another possibility that the surrounding electrons, which increase in Z, number of electrons in the atom will increase, and the release of that electron also is hindered. That is called screening of electrons. This is to the tune of 2%. So both these factors can be seen from the measured spectrum. Now we will not go into the details, but I will tell the gist. From this theory, comparative half-lives for a relation for half-life in the form of comparative half-life, I will explain, were made. that is frequency factor into t. And from that, we can calculate, compute what would be the f value, and from that we can arrive at their decay probabilities. They are very useful in the selection rules, but I would have loved to take an example. In fact, I have an example here. Hopefully, if Tomar gives at the end of the lecture, and if you are all interested, I will take a tutorial on all these problems, whatever assignment I am giving. So, you have to remember certain selection rules here, because we are dealing with the individual nucleons. Beta decay, we are dealing with the individual nucleons. Therefore, delta I value, nuclear spin, which is the sum of the angular moment of all the nucleon, we have seen already, only the last nucleon is, unpaired nucleon is important for calculating delta I. Similarly, I value, similarly L value and parity. Remember, if the difference of the initial and final nucleus delta I is lower, then probability for the decay is very high. Same case with the L. And L will decide the shape of the nuclear wave function. Then depending on its shape, right, nuclear shape, depending on its shape, the de-excitation, if it is simple spherical, de-excitation is more favorable. When n is equal to 0, that is favorable. If both the parent and daughter are having L is equal to 0, S states, then its decay is very easy. And if there is no change in the pi, that is pi value, both, let us say both are positive, that is parity, both are positive or both are negative, then also decay is favorable. For example, if delta I is 0, if there is no change in the spin value and the change in the L value is 0, and no change in parity, that is, take an example of a half plus of delta I, final nucleus also half plus, therefore parity, both are plus, no change, both are half, 0, both are S states, therefore 0. In such cases, decay is super allowed, means decay is very fast. Such decays are classified as the super allowed. And log of values decides whether it belongs to super allowed or allowed, first forbidden, second forbidden, and so on and so forth. All the decay, all the beta decay are classified based on the half life into different groups, like super allowed, allowed, first forbidden, second forbidden, etc., etc. But the criteria, that is observation, criteria is based on the delta I, delta I, L, delta pi, that is change in the nucleus spin, change in the L value, and change in the parity, between the initial nucleus and final nucleus. So if delta I is, all the three are 0, means 0 delta I, no change in the nuclear spin, no change in the L value, and no parity change, that is super allowed. And if delta L is, conditions are same, let us say delta I is equal to 0, delta I is, L is equal to 1, and there is a change in parity, then it is L forbidden. I don't know whether anybody has reviewed their shell model. If you change delta is equal to 1, parity change will be there. How many of you can answer this? Put on the mic and tell me. Anybody? All right, I'll tell. If it is a open class, I would demand it. When delta L is equal to 1, means there is a L value change. Suppose even value is the L value for the parent nucleus. In the decay process, we said delta is equal to 1. Then what will happen? Let us say initial L value is equal to 1 or 2. And final value, is equal to 1. That means from even value it has become odd value. And we know parity is minus 1 to the power of L. If minus 1 to the power of L is positive, we say parity is positive. If minus 1 to the power of L is negative, we say negative. Odd. So therefore, whenever delta L is equal to 1, parity change will be there. We need not even look into that. Okay? Okay. If delta I is equal to 0, delta L is equal to 1, and delta pi, there is a change in parity, then it is L for good because of the change in the L value. Now, like that, I have made a series of things here, and I suggest you read one of the books Dr. Tomer has given you. Otherwise, at the end, I will give for this part books. And in one of the books, we have published one, and that this is given in details with examples. And second forbidden, delta I is equal to 2, L is equal, delta L is equal to 2, delta pi is equal to 1. Remember, the more L value, the delta L is becoming larger and larger, then life becomes tougher and tougher for this beta decay to take place. That is a thumb rule, because shape is getting changed. And then the decay processes will be hindered. Okay. Now, yeah, I just read this line. Depending on these values, log FT value range also we can see. For each transition, we know what is the expected range. They are not. There is no fine demarcation. 6 to 15 we can call as this part. Delta I is equal to 1, right? Delta L is equal to 1, delta pi is equal to S, right? First forbidden. And they will have a log FT value of 6 to 15. Whereas for this, log FT value will be around 1. So it is really super low. So from using those values, we can calculate, compute also half-lives, or use the value and get the F. If you have the measured half life, you can get the log of time, so on and so forth. Right? Okay. And this I have given to for you to get a feel that there is something called comparative half life. There is a way to compute. There are some selections. Otherwise, in 15 minutes, it will be a surprise if most of you follow. Right? Difficult if you are newcomers. Now, I have given an example here, which you can repeat in your tutorial, which I will give, right? Same problem I will do. Cesium-137 is having 30.07 years of life. And its ground state spin is 7 by 2, parity is positive. And it can, I mean, measurements say that ground state to ground state of the daughter product transition, both are, there are two beta decays. There are two beta decay groups. Remember that beta decay, like alpha decay, can have the fine structure. There can be more than one set of beta particles, right? That is fine structure. Okay. Now, this is ground to ground transition, which is having a lower probability. This is only 0.08, whereas that is 8%. Whereas 92%, they undergo, they get transition from ground state to excited state of barium-137, that is daughter product. Now, you have to remember again, here also, the beta decay, if they have many beta groups, energy groups, they will populate the excited states in the daughter product. Again, this, if it undergoes gamma decay, de-excitation, this gamma ray is attributed to the parent nucleus. It is called 137 cesium gamma ray. Because of this decay, it is getting populated. as long as this parent nucleus exists, this gamma you can see. Okay, and this is a gamma ray standard interaction detection NAPET. Okay, now what is the problem here? Whereas the, in one go, when you are leaving a lot of energy, that is about 1.17 MeV, it has a very low probability. Whereas here, about 5-10 MeV, the probability is very high, right? And we are not concerned about this energy at this stage. Now the question is, there is an intermediate state, what we call metastable state, and that is having a half-life of 2.25 minutes, and this we call metastable state. We can actually compute both the spin values of these two states. Of course, this is zero because it is a stable nucleus. We can calculate, this zero is energy state. From shell model, we can calculate this value. Whereas this we can compute based on the transition or the selection rules. From this we can calculate log of the value and we can calculate or vice versa, right? Once we know this, then the probability for the de-excitation, we can find out, is it a favorable de-excitation or not? Gamma de-excitation probability. This is the beauty of both beta and gamma de-excitation. Okay, log FP for the first forbidden. What is first forbidden here? 8.8. Huh? And what is that? That is going to the M state. First forbidden means you will not remember for sure. Delta I is equal to 1, delta L also is equal to 1. Okay. And delta L is plus minus 2 for this state. And you get a value from this. From this, we can compute what could be the L value. It could be either 11 by 2 or 3 by 2. But this needs a board and explanation. But I would like you to venture into this. And actually, assigned value is 11 by 2 minus. So up to this point, one could reach, right? Either 11 by 2 minus S, there is a change because it is plus. Because if there is a change in parity, it will become minus and minus. The question is it 11 by 2 minus or 3 by 2 minus? And assigned value is 11 by 2. And we can actually, in fact, we can arrive at the value of I value of this source, nuclear spin and parity for this source. These are the some of the, just to get a feel, I am telling, right? I am not going into the details, cannot go into details at this point. Okay. Tomar, how much is time is there?
Yeah, I think we usually close at 4 o'clock. So now it's 4:15.
Maybe now, what is the time? What is the time, please?
4:15. 4:15.
3:15.
4:15.
4:15. Just in 5 minutes, I will just give introduction to gamma decay and move. Okay. And this problem also, I will give in the assignment and explain you if at all time is there. Otherwise, I will write and give you. This is another example. And gamma transitions, as the third part is gamma. And people call gamma decay. Actually, it is gamma transitions. There is nothing like decay here. So an excited state emits energy by emitting a gamma ray. And each gamma ray will have multipolarities, and we can get, in fact, we can arrive at the multipolarities, spin and pi. From that we can get the nuclear structure, and it's very, very important. Gamma ray measurement is very important in arriving at the nuclear structure, and experimentally also, we, most of our experiments, we measure the gamma ray, we use the gamma ray spectrometry, and better to have some idea that if there are two states, ground state and not necessarily ground state, excited states are there, there is a possibility that they will come down, and in the process they will emit the energy which is in the form of the gamma ray. But all the time you need not expect a emission of a photon, a gamma ray. There is a possibility that this energy can be converted into converted means this energy can be utilized to emit an electron, what we call, earlier days people used to call it as internal conversion, as it is gamma ray is converted to an electron. No, gamma ray energy, excitation energy was given to the one of the atomic orbital electrons, and in the process, if that gets energy more than the binding energy, then that can be emitted, that can be that can come out of the influence of the atom. We call it as internal conversion. So internal conversion is a completing process for gamma de-excitation, but there is no conversion. Instead of gamma, you see an electron. And similarly, pair production is another process which is completing. In interaction of radiation, I will be explaining the meaning of pair production. Simultaneously, an electron and a positron are produced. In fact, that was the first proof for Einstein's theory of E equal to mc square. And isomers, already we have seen the word, right? Isomers also de-excite by emitting a gamma ray or so. Isomer is again an arbitrary definition. If lifetime is more than 10 power minus 12 seconds, now we call them excited states. If they are measurable, then they are called isomeric states. This happens only when there is a large difference of the spin and parity. There is a large difference in the spin between these two states, and there is a change in parity, then that state will have an intermediate, there is a transient lifetime, what is called isomeric state. Now, there is no definite borderline between lifetime of an excited state and isomeric state. So isomers occur if delta A is large, and as I told you, there is nothing like delta pi is large. Delta pi is yes, change in the, again there is a correction, delta pi is there, there is change in the delta pi, there is parity change. And isomers exist in the nuclear shell closure as well as mid-shell regions, right? That you know by this time the meaning of nuclear shells, magic numbers. Gamma ray carries integral units of L value, and depending on the L value, the gamma ray will have the multipolarity, that is multipoles, right? If the value is zero, value is 1, you call dipole, value is 2, you call quadrupole, and so on and so forth, right? And that can be measured. Now, there are selection rules for this also. Actually, an ideal thing is to explain this slide. Okay, I'll just quickly give you a small glimpse of this. If you know the final and initial and final states as spin value, we'll be in a position to see the expected multipolarity of the gamma ray. If I was telling you L is equal to 1 is a dipole, L is equal to 2 is quadrupole, M3 is that is for electric, and these values also associated with the change in, there could be change in parity. You have this gamma transitions are facilitated by, due to the change in the charge distribution and the current distribution. Charge distribution reflects in electric moments, and current distribution reflects in the magnetic moments. Both can be measured. And if II plus IF is greater than L, greater than II plus IF, in this such conditions, we can find out what are the multipolarities. And remember this, in this, electric multipoles will compete with the magnetic multipoles plus 1. Means an electric multipole of L value is equal to 1 will compete with magnetic multipole of 2, M2. They are comparable probabilities, right? So parity for electrical is minus 1 to the power of L, like we are using in shell model. Whereas for magnetic component, if you want to know, minus 1 to the power of L plus 1 minus 2. For example, 2 plus 3 to 3 plus is the change. here. Okay, this is 2 plus and this is 3 plus. Then L values can be the difference, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, etc. Delta pi is no, because both are plus. So no parity change. Once no parity change means EL would be minus 1 to the power of, L should be L. So it can be E2 and E4. Whereas ML would be M1, M3 and M5. So this will have a combination of the emitted gamma ray will have the multi polarities of electrical components of E2, E4 and magnetic M1, M3, M5. However, this M3, M5 will be having lower probability, and in fact measured value, all these are possible. As I told you, this EL and ML plus 1 are the possibilities for the given L value. So M1, and for this L value, you can have E2, E4, M1, M3, M5. Therefore, this multipolarity of the emitted radiation will be M1, E2, M3, E4, M5, all these. And as we go to the higher number, these values will become lower probability. Actually, the measured multipolarity of this particular gamma radiation is M1 plus E2. So these selection rules are of, these are selection rules. These are the selection rules. These are the selection rules which will help us, based on that, which will help us to compute what is the expected multipolarities of an emitted radiation. So one can plan an experiment to measure the electric dipole, in this case, electric quadrupole and magnetic dipole. So if electric quadrupole measurements are made, then this gamma radiation can be characterized. And from that, we can get towards the nuclear structure. This is the way. But I have, I have gone through it very quickly, which is against my principle. I don't believe in completing the syllabus, but there is not much of a chance. So at this stage, I will close stating that alpha decay, beta decay processes, I tried to explain. There is gamma transition. I just can't. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Reddy. There is one question from one student.
Yeah.
And that question is, whether the Coulombic barrier is constant or Z dependent?
It is Z dependent. Z1, Z2, E square by R. Z1, Z square. If it is alpha is Z1, 2E, and Z is atomic number of the parent nucleus is Z, and that is Z, you call Z1, Z1 into 2 E square by R. So it is depending on the parent nucleus atomic number. But on average, it is between 18 to 22.
Thank you. I think now I would just like to inform the participants that the assignment is already on the Anuvidya site. So the participants can take this assignment and then submit the assignments to the Gmail account which I had given during the instruction to participants in the inaugural function. So I hope all the participants have written their name and affiliation in the chat box so that we know that you are present. And thank you. So we meet on Friday, tomorrow at 3 p.m.
Okay. Introduction of radiation.
Yeah. Thank you all. Thank you.
And Tomar, one point.
Yeah.
Friday, I will be giving assignment on this BK.
Okay.
And solutions also I will give later.
Okay.
I am not at all happy with this last two projections.
Yeah, yeah. So if you could send me maybe tomorrow, then we can upload them on the website. Or maybe
tomorrow. By tomorrow. Tonight itself, I am thinking of sending that.
Okay. Okay. Thank you all. Thank you. Bye-bye. See you tomorrow, 3 p.m.